So I guess the first question you want to ask is, why am I talking about legitimacy at all? Mostly people don't talk about legitimacy when they're talking about political economy. And when they talk about politics, they're talking about legitimacy, but they don't really focus on the Eurozone crisis in that case. And when they're talking about governance, they're also, you know, sort of procedures of EU Commission, whatever, they're still not talking much about legitimacy. And it occurred to me that basically legitimacy is a perfect lens to enable, through which I can look at all aspects of the crisis. And since I've been obsessed with all aspects of the crisis, I was trying to think, how do I pull them together? And it's only really through the sort of lens of legitimacy, and I'll explain why in a minute, but it enables me to look at political economy, at politics, and at governance processes. And I mean, it's important to ask, and the reason I use legitimacy is when you think about the actors in the EU, when you think about the tools political scientists have, they usually start with, oh, they're rational agents, et cetera, they're basically calculating. I heard you mention game theory earlier. They're calculating on the basis of their rational interests. They respond to incentive structures, the way we need to restructure the euro, et cetera. Or you have people talking about, you know, they're following their roles, they have to do this because this is what they're told they have to do, that's been established, it's path dependent, they can't change this. That's more the historical institutional approach. Or you even get a few, not many, who talk about, well, they're reenacting cultural scripts, or that it's about the frames through which they see the crisis. You know, all of these are absolutely right. They're very useful ways to get at different aspects of the crisis, but they don't really tell us enough about who these people are, what their motivations are, and how they're thinking. And basically, I'm taking EU actors as people, real people, meaning sentient beings who think, who speak, who act, and therefore also seek to legitimate their own actions. This is about them, how these actors themselves think. Does this work? Doesn't that work? I'm sure it's going to work this way. And oh my God, no, it doesn't. And how do I legitimate my actions then to all of the various, to the public, but also to the other EU actors? So it's about legitimacy. And for this, I use what I call discursive institutionalism, which I see as complementary to the other kinds of institutionalism. This is about substantive content of ideas and the interactive processes of discourse in institutional context. This is what people think, what they say, to whom they say it, where, when, and how. But you need to understand, in particular institutional context, but you understand institutional context in two ways. One is the meaning context, the logical communication. When they say structural form, what is it they mean? And when they talk about you, Italy, have to do structural reform, what's the logic of communication there? But beyond that, it's also within, I use all of the results of all the other kinds of approaches as background information. We need to know about the institutions. We do need to know about their role. We need to know about their material interests and what might act as, what might serve as institutional structures. And we need to know about their cultural frames. So this is not saying either or, this is saying and. But importantly, by using discursive institutionalism, which takes people's ideas seriously, it provides a bridge to philosophy, to values, to questions of legitimacy that are, of course, deeply grounded in political philosophy, political theory, et cetera. And it enables to create a bridge between empirics and values. If there's time later, I'll also talk to you about how it enables us to think about power and the power of ideas via discourse. But that's, you know, that's other papers, and that's only if you're interested in that, will be later. For now, we're just focusing on legitimacy. So here's the empirics, here's the story. What, you know, how do we explain the Eurozone crisis? And of course, it's not just a crisis of economics, it's also of politics and democracy. And it's basically in the absence of deeper political integration, without any kind of democratic representation and control, at the same time that you've got divided preferences, institutional constraints, legal obstacles to taking action, that people don't know what to do, and even if they think they know what to do, almost impossible to do anything. They end up governing by rules and ruling by numbers. what you saw is that in the immediate moment of the crisis, you see a reinforcement of the Stability and Growth Pact. Remember, that goes back to the Maastricht Treaty. And subsequent to the Maastricht Treaty, they all agree on a Stability and Growth Pact. And this gets reinforced through the six-pack, the two-pack, the fiscal compact, through legislative action and treaties, in exchange for loan bailouts. And this puts democratic legitimacy at risk. The EU rules become substitutes for national politics or even EU policymaking. And ultimately what happens, and we see it very, very quickly in the macroeconomic as well as microeconomic figures, it leads to deteriorating economies. And with the deterioration in the economies, you get increasingly toxic politics. You get the rise of populist extremes. It's the rise of Euroscepticism, anti-Euro feeling, even anti-EU feeling. And you can trace, although there's a slow rise of populism across time, or let's call it just extreme rights. I think populism is an ongoing phenomenon, but it spikes with the Eurozone crisis. Not to say that that's the only reason for populism by 2015, immigration, that had been the main issue before the Eurozone crisis, and then Euro adds to it, obviously, the anti-immigration forces rears its ugly head again, but it's a combination. It's bad economics, it's the background of Euro that is important in order to understand why we get that. But in any case, you get toxic politics as well as deteriorating economies, and what's EU's actors' response? They start reinterpreting the rules by stealth. They can't say anything because how do you change the rules, especially given the decision rules in the EU? So they do it by stealth, and this is the story I'm going to be telling you. And they can't admit it. They have to claim they stick to the rules. Actually, they don't have to, but they do. And what we see is incremental change for the better in terms of the economies. But you still have suboptimal rules and citizens' perceptions, north and south, of illegitimacy for a whole range of reasons that we'll go into in a minute. So that's basically the empirical case. So now we have to step back a minute and say, what's democracy? What's legitimacy? I realized when I first was writing this and I had the introduction, the first theory chapter, etc., I had someone read it who said, yeah, but you haven't defined legitimacy. Oh, no. Anyway, now I'm giving you a definition of legitimacy. And I say this about myself, but read any book about legitimacy. And they never define it, or at least never clearly. Because I went looking then, okay, who can solve my problem very quickly? They didn't. So how do you define? So basically, here's my very quick and dirty definition, because I didn't want to write another book at the same time. Democracy is a form of representative government with a whole range of other pluses that you know, rule of law, freedom of the press, etc. But democracy, form of representative government. And so there are two ways of thinking about legitimacy, and ordinarily, we think about the Weberian kind of legitimacy. Legitimacy in terms of a governing authority, that is, that any form of government, any form, democratic or not, is legitimate when it has public consent, when it's accepted by its citizens. That's legitimacy in terms of governing authority. But there's another kind of legitimacy, and that's the one that I'm going to be talking about today, which is as governing activity. And much of the literature actually focuses on governing activity, and they say, oh, and by the way, there's this other kind, you know, sort of underlying this in terms of governing authority. But it's complicated in the EU, given that the EU is a multi-level system, which we'll get to in a minute. But anyway, legitimacy as governing activity is when an elected government is accepted as legitimate by the citizens because it governs responsibly and responsively in ways that benefit the public interest and in keeping with common values. Basically, it's all about governing activity. Of course, this reinforces governing authority. And of course, if governments don't govern responsibly, are not responsive either, have bad outcomes, then of course that undermines their authority. So there's a very close linkage. But both are necessary. But generally speaking, what we look at when we talk about legitimacy in the crisis is about governing activity. So is the big question, is the EU democratic legitimacy? question a bit, but as a governing authority, what you could argue is that the barrier on legitimacy has been incrementally established policy area by policy area. As it becomes a customs union, as the European Court of Justice is accepted as has a supremacy, as particular areas, as the international trade representative, yeah. So each area, there's a certain giving up of sovereignty, and it's deliberate, it's debated, governments accept it, and tacitly as a result, citizens do. So what you could argue is that, in fact, the EU is legitimate as a governing authority, but is it democracy? Is it democratic? That's a bit more complicated, and I think technically you wouldn't say that it's a democracy in terms of the way we think of nation-state democracies, elected governments, etc. However, its member states are democracies. It operates with democratic principles, and the EU is its member states. It's not as if you can say, here's the EU and here are the member states, unless, of course, you're the UK in the midst of Brexit, and then, of course, it's the EU, Brussels there, and no. I mean, basically, it's the member states are part of the EU, the EU is part, there's no way you can separate it. But, I mean, there is one big problem, and this is my Democracy in Europe book from 2006, which is the very existence of the EU undermines national democracy, member states' democracies, as decisions are made, taken to the EU level. Needless to say, policies that used to be decided at the national level are at the EU level, and the EU doesn't have the kind of representative government where, so people who, anyway, we'll talk about that in a minute. But still, you know, you can say that the EU is democratic even if you don't want to say it's a democracy. So in many ways, you could argue that it is indeed democratic legitimate. But what about governing activity? And of course, that depends. That depends on which policy area we're looking at and which activities. And this is, of course, why I'm looking at the Eurozone. So how do we theorize the legitimacy of the EU's governing activities in the Eurozone crisis? So how do we think about legitimacy? And here, I'm going to look to the EU studies literature, and they basically use terms that are kind of terrible, systems terms. I remember when I first saw this, talking to Fritz Sharp, who brought them back in, input and output. I said, this is ridiculous. I had very harsh words about it. But in any case, here I find myself using them, so apologies. And even inventing or bringing back in a term within the systems. But it's actually pretty useful. So if you hate systems, think political performance and procedural. If you like it because you think it actually works, think output, input, or input, output, and throughput. So it's David Easton who brings these terms. I was at the University of Chicago where David Easton was there. And I also thought, oh, this system stuff, what is this? Here I am, honoring his work. Okay. So what is output legitimacy? This is a performance criterion. It basically says, you know, if you think about Abraham Lincoln's term, government by, of, and for the people, this is for the people. This is policies for the people. It's focused on the common good. And you basically decide whether something is legitimate because it's the policies are effective, they lead to good performance. Are the Eurozone policies effective? Do they lead to good performance? If the economies get better, then their output legitimate. If they don't, then there are problems. Input legitimacy is a political criteria. This is when we think about democratic legitimacy in normal parlance, this is what we're thinking of. It's politics, in Abraham Lincoln's terms, is government by and of the people. And it's about responding to the will of the people. It's judged on the basis of citizens' representation and participation, but also government's responsiveness to the people. These two criteria often seem to involve trade-offs. You can question this, and I might as well, but generally speaking, they say, you know, the people had nothing to do with this, it was a technocratic decision, policies were provided, and actually they were effective. So the fact that citizens had nothing to do with it does not matter. This is legitimate simply because good output. Or, on the other hand, you might have people saying, oh, this is the stupidest policy anyone ever thought of. The people voted for this. It doesn't work, but it's still legitimate because the people want it. So trade-off. The third criterion, which is a procedural criterion, processes, and I add another preposition to Abraham Lincoln. I added this in my 2006 book, but it actually still comes in handy. It's basically governing processes with the people. It's about inclusiveness and openness, as well as efficacy, accountability, transparency. And I came up with throughput, and I didn't realize this, but actually there were a number of Germans and people from neighboring countries who in the early 2000s had also come up with the term, but I thought I had invented it. I mean, following Easton, but you know, so it happens. But what was embarrassing is I'm presenting the first time in Berlin at a Thomas Risse and Tanya Bertzel, and Tanya Bertzel is commenting on it. This is 2010, and she says, but Vivian, why didn't you cite Thomas? What? Anyway, I had done a search, but I hadn't found it. You know, I put in throughput, but hadn't found it. Anyway, it turns out that Thomas Risse and Marika Kleine had did one article on throughput legitimacy, and then there were a variety of Germans, Artur Benz, Yanis Papadopoulos, and some Dutch fellows who had basically used the term, not quite the way I had. Michael Zorn, I was giving a talk there at the Witzer Beck just the next week. I thought, oh, thank God I found out. So I could then say, oh, Michael, I'm building on what you said. Well, he said, I abandoned it in 2004. I said, that's fine. I'm doing something different. But anyway, this is just to say the dangers of all of this. But anyway, I thought I had, when I had come up with it, it was really to try to say, okay, we've got input and output. We know that they cover a whole range of things. But then you have these other terms, accountability, transparency, inclusiveness, openness, efficacy, and these are all about procedural legitimacy, but they're all over the place, and no one puts them together. So I said, let's put them together in order to be able to then to see how they, you know, what the trade-offs might be, their relationship to input and output, or to political and performance legitimacy. And what I find is there are no trade-offs. Whereas there's a trade-off between input and output, there are no trade-offs for throughput. If it's good, you know, if the civil servants or even parliamentarians follow good procedures, they're efficacious, they're accountable, they're transparent, who cares? The citizens don't know about it, that's fine. Because it means that you go from input, the citizens say we want this, to good policies, good performance, and back around again. However, if civil servants or politicians are perceived to be corrupt in their procedures, incompetent, they do a really bad job of putting this through, oppressive, as in the Eurozone, when they're dealing with Greece, or with Spain, or with Italy, or with Portugal, okay, we don't need to go on. That taints, that skews the political input and taints the output. Because people say if the processes are wrong, then it means that the politics isn't, you know, that our vote isn't being respected appropriately, etc. So this is a tremendously important concept, throughput legitimacy or procedural legitimacy, but it doesn't have the same weight in, say, the political process, at least in terms of the perception of citizens. If we think that citizens are the ones who, at the end of the day, end up determining what is legitimate. I think that is, but there's a case for, you know, but anyway, we're not going into that for technocrats. Okay, so that's all the theory. So just to give you a nice confusing picture, input, and of course it's confusing because you've got multi-level governance going on in the EU, but citizens vote for governments that are part of the council, but citizens also vote for the European Parliament. The national governments are expected to be politically responsive, but also accountable and transparent. So they have a mix of things. And so you've got both input and output for the national governments, and the So now I'm going to go faster and sort of try to go through the crisis. So how do we think about output legitimacy in the crisis? So what about the output effectiveness of the ideas? So you had a Brussels-Frankfurt consensus, the Commission, the ECB, Germany, have a consensus on what the guiding principles are. Ordoliberalism, which is the German obsession with sound money, stability, and all the rest, and that's all the economists are trained that way. That is the philosophy of macroeconomic policy in Germany since the 50s, basically. That's the Bundesbank philosophy, and when the Bundesbank principles migrate to the European Central Bank, same principles. And so it's about stable finance, but in addition to the macroeconomic policy ideas or more microeconomic, neoliberal ideas about structural reform. You know, basically, crush labor unions and everything will be fine. At least that was the initial way in which structural reform was interpreted. And of course, what happens at the time is sort of, there's not only about background philosophy that we have to be concerned about, but it's also failures in framing. The crisis happens, and when the financial crisis hit, everyone said it's about, obviously, private debt, that's it's the banks, that's the real problem. The minute the Eurozone crisis hits, there's a switch in the discourse, and now it's about public debt. And of course, part of the reason for that is the crisis starts in Greece, which was about public debt. But it's not true in any of the other countries that ended up having harsh austerity and structural reform imposed. They were all pretty good. It was about a financial, a stop of cash flow into, of money, of banks, and et cetera, going in. But anyway, it was framed as public debt, not private. And then, of course, well, if it's public debt, it must be that they were bad. They did wrong things. It's about behavior. And therefore, rather than saying it's something about the structure of the euro that doesn't work, which it didn't, they expected everyone to converge economically, and instead you got increasing divergence between surplus and current account surplus and deficit countries, etc. So failures in diagnosis, bad choices of remedies. They double down on the rules. They say, public debt, you were bad, you know, bad behavior. We are going to now enforce the rules in a way we never did. As opposed to saying, maybe there are other things we can do. Maybe we need to fix the Eurozone. Maybe we need to think about, in terms of solutions, more redistributive measures, create Eurobonds, create some kind of fiscal solidarity, a European Monetary Fund, etc. None of these things happened. And then on top of that, if you then look at what about the performance, two ways of judging output, policy effectiveness, and then the actual outcomes in terms of performance, what happened? Macroeconomic divergence increases. You continue to have these big differences in surplus and deficit countries. And there's little or no growth. It's anemic in Northern Europe, and it's very bad in Southern Europe. It's in the negative numbers. And you know, you can say, oh yeah, but it was everywhere. No, in the US, which had a more pragmatic policy, it's Democrats against Republicans, but it's the Fed and Obama pushing for fiscal stimulus, even as the Republicans pull back, it still means that there was a much more pragmatic response in the US, and you can see it in terms of growth in the US compared to the EU. And within the EU, you see massive differences between Northern Europe and Southern Europe. And of course, we see massive rises in unemployment and poverty, and you get reports from the Council of Europe, Caritas, and the European Parliament on a humanitarian crisis in Europe. So I'm just going to give you two slides. I have a number of others I can show you later if you're interested. Here, output gaps, or the difference between potential and actual output, i.e. in terms of economic performance. And what you see is Germany, after sharp downturn, and everyone's sharp, it recovers and is basically doing very well. And on other slides that I don't think I have on here, I can show you that it and the US track about the same. But of course, the US includes all of its states. This is only Germany. And then if you look at all the other countries you can see how bad it is.
Poor Greece.
Spain is doing very poorly as well. So is Italy. And so they're, you know, by 2018, this is a long time after the crisis. By 2018, 8 years later, they are beginning to get better, but they're still nowhere up to recovering. And of course, Greece is just languishing. And then just to another, this is unemployment dispersion in the Eurozone area. It's great if you're in Austria, Germany, and Luxembourg. That's where you go if you want jobs. They're dying for people. This is the EU European average, Euro area average. And this is Greece, Portugal, and Spain. In terms of levels of unemployment. I have other slides on NEETs, neither in employment or training, education or training, and you know, the numbers are catastrophic for these same, for those same countries, plus Italy. France is not doing so well. No one's doing very well, but anyway. Okay, so that's on the economic side. So I think I have convinced you, I hope, that there are real problems with output legitimacy here. And of course, needless to say, there are often generally feedbacks from bad output to the input, and what we see is serious problems with input legitimacy in terms of people's attitudes. But we start with the EU level, and so what about legitimacy there? What you see immediately upon the crisis, Sarkozy, of course, always from France, always wanting to be demonstrate that he's in charge, comes in and says, we've got to do something. And says it's the most democratic way of doing this is the European member state governments to decide in the European Council. Merkel, after some hesitation, says, I actually like this European Union method, and you get massive intergovernmentalism. Lots of people have written about this, but basically decisions are made at the top level. And Andrew Mrawczyk thinks he's right, that it's about intergovernmentalism. And in fact, at this moment, you know, basically the European Parliament is sidelined. It doesn't have much of a role anyway to begin with in the Eurozone, but it's even less. And the Commission is treated like a secretariat. At the national level, what you see is sort of the big problem is, this is Peter Mayer's rendition of, you know, that the problem for national governments is that they, supranational says you need to be responsible to your international agreements. You know, you've got to be responsible and follow your international or supranational EU agreements. And yet, they're elected by the citizens in their country, and they need to be responsive. So they're caught between these two. And ultimately, they do what they follow the international or their supranational agreements, what the EU says they need to do. And needless to say, the citizens hold them accountable, and they hold them accountable for the bad politics and for the bad economics. And so we see increasing cycling of national governments, tremendous loss of trust. You see this in all the figures, and I'll have to show you a picture of that in a minute. The image of the EU just plummets. You see the debates become very much renationalized. It's the, the best example is Germany versus Greece. You know, the Germans say, we Germans say, versus you lazy Greeks. And the Greeks have pictures of Chancellor Merkel with Hitler mustaches and stormtrooper boots. So renationalization of debates in all sorts of ways with very bad stereotypes that come out. Increasing electoral divide, this is sort of the major findings of much of the literature. Lisbeth Hugo and Gary Marx, Hans-Peter Kreese, and collaborators all basically say the same thing. In addition to the normal left-right divisions, now you have cross-cutting cleavages, and it's about xenophobic versus cosmopolitan voters. Other terms, the Galtan for Hugo and Marx, but in any case, it's basically the same thing. But there's these cross-cutting cleavages that also make it very difficult to respond and to know what to do. And of course, we get the rise of populist Eurosceptics extremes on the right, the left, but also in the center you get Euroskeptics. And on top of this, and this is a really good article by Daniele Caramani in the American Political Science Review, of all places, basically on technocracy and populism, and that both things are highly problematic for mainstream party politics. Because at the same time the populists say you're corrupt, et cetera, the technocrats assume by definition, this is the rational choice to set as assumptions, assume by definition that politicians are rent seekers and therefore corrupt. They won't do the right thing. So that you get an undermining of national democracy by both, not just the populists, but also the technocrats who say, take it even farther out of the hands of the public, of the citizens. Problematic, obviously, because the citizens are claiming that we want to take back control. If that reminds you of the Brexit debate. I mean, it should. Okay, and so what you get is increasing politicization. And it's politicization, three kinds of politicization. And I think I've got a piece coming out in the Journal of European Public Policy talking about this in greater detail. But it's politicization at the bottom, and that is the rise of populism and all of the things that I've described. There's politicization from the bottom up, so increasing politicization at the national level means that member state leaders and ministers in the council, of course, reflect their citizens' views, the people who voted for them, and they have become increasingly political in the way in which they interact. You only have to look at Hungary and Poland. But also Germany. Merkel refused to help solve the crisis when it could have been done pretty quickly, i.e. when Greece in October 2009 said, hey, we have a problem. But no, she was waiting for the lender elections in May 2010. In Nordrhein-Westphalia, she was waiting to win in that, so she was basically saying, I'm not going to do anything. I'm not crazy. And of course, turns out it was the biggest miscalculation you possibly do, because they lost that election, and of course, the euro nearly blew up in their faces. But this is about national politics. There was a media feeding frenzy in Germany that she didn't do anything to counter. On the contrary, she went along with it. So that's politics, if you will, from the bottom up. But then there's also politics at the top. And that politics at the top is how not only within the council, Germany versus, right now, Italy, as we've got this great drama, but also the Commission versus Italy now, but also Germany versus the Commission. Wolfgang Schäuble, not happy with the way the Commission is dealing with France or Italy or Spain, letting them off the hook, giving them derogations. And so you get more and more political battles. Remember, we used to think of the EU level as policy without politics. And I wrote this in 2006. But now I have realized that was true then. But we have something else going on now. And it's increasingly become policy with politics at the EU level. And at the national level, at the time I had written about politics without policy, because you still had national level politics, but policy decision making was at the EU level. But now what you get at the national level is increasingly politics against policy in particular areas, in particular in terms of Europe. So, politicization with very serious effects as a result of the Eurozone crisis. And then, of course, it follows once we get the immigration crisis. But this is where you see the start. So just to give you a sense of how bad the image of the EU is, here, very favorable, negative, people with a negative view, totally negative view, are only 15%. And the positive view is 50%. But look what happens here. They're almost at the same level of image, which shows a tremendous decline in the view. And in 2017, all you have to do is read the Commission report saying, look, the image of the EU is much better, but tremendous variation in terms of image. Portugal, interestingly enough, now has a positive view. It wouldn't have been true in earlier years. But France is not very positive. It's certainly more positive than Greece or Italy. But the negative views, Greece and Italy in particular, have gone up. So again, it's differentiation amongst member states. And similarly, you can't read this, but basically, it's, I would like to ask you a question about how much trust you have in certain media institutions. Tell me if you tend to trust it or tend not to trust it, and this is the EU. And what you see is a massive decline in trust in the EU, a peak in 2007, and then it goes down, but it's still not too bad until 2010. They're still waiting, but by 2011-12, when the worst of the austerity and structural reform happens, the views are tremendously negative about the European Union. National governments are even in worse shape, as well as national parliaments. Just to tell you, if you're asking, you know, can prove that there's a problem with the politics, you can see massive problems, loss of trust. This is at the basis of the legitimacy of governing authority. And this is a result of governing problems with the governing activities. But again, if you want to look at differences amongst countries, you see the story is even worse. Because what happens is that in terms of levels of trust, they go down very fast and they don't recover in most of these countries. Germany's the only country where the trust goes up. Surprise, surprise. Because Germany is essentially in charge. Well, in its own particular way. Okay, so what about throughput legitimacy? Since I've given you such a build-up to throughput legitimacy, how do we think about throughput legitimacy? And here as well, I've already told you part of this story. EU actors first reinforce the rules. Look, they assume, look, all we have to do is have quality throughput, double down on the rules, and that will give us good output, and therefore we don't need for any citizen input. But point is, when they're faced with bad policy output, performance, and increased political input volatility, what you see is they reinterpret the rules by stealth. They increase flexibility, and I can describe that in a couple minutes. They increase flexibility, but they don't admit it in the discourse. And the problem with this, as I mentioned earlier, is if the output, they taint perceptions of policy outcomes. You know, if they're not changing the rules, or at least if they appear not to be changing, because the discourse says harsh austerity and structural reform, this is what the Commission is doing, actors appear stubborn, illogical, incompetent, and in any case, they have suboptimal results because they're not changing the rule. In terms of input, skews the politics because it misleads. The Spaniards will feel oppressed even when they're accommodated, and the Germans will feel deceived regardless. And with throughput legitimacy, the administrative discretion that the Commission is using under the radar thwarts accountability, because they're not telling the Council, which is essentially their masters, their principals, what they're doing. It undermines transparency, quite obviously. And the efficacy of all of this is in question. And of course, it also jeopardizes things like trust and legality. So now, very, very quickly, how do we think about these various actors? The ECB, is it the hero or the ogre? As it goes from one size fits none, in terms of the Eurozone rules, to whatever it takes. This is Mario Draghi's line in 2012, when he basically says to the markets, get off my back. He doesn't say he's a lender of last resort, but the markets think that's what he's saying, and that's good. So obviously, in terms of macroeconomic policy and his discourse, basically, the ECB is the hero in terms of monetary policy. The idea is he goes from credibility to stability. It's interesting to just to see what goes on. It starts out, and here's the picture. Word use frequency. It starts out where you get a discourse of competitiveness, and then it quickly shifts to stability. It slowly shifts to stability and stays at economy, and that is essentially a discursive strategy on the part of central bankers. You can see it in the articles members of the ECB wrote and in their speeches. They basically go from credibility, which was Jean-Claude Trichet's statement, we have to be credible, we can't talk to the member state leaders, we have to, you know, make sure everyone follows the rules, and we can't ever be a lender of last resort. That's what Trichet says, and very, very narrowly defines what they can do, so that as the Fed and the Bank of England engage in quantitative easing beginning in 2008, the ECB does very little. It's faced with a major crisis in 2010, it does a little more, but it doesn't do much. You know, and it's only in 2012 when it says, okay, you know, we'll do whatever it takes, but it doesn't have to do anything because the market stopped their attacks. And by 2015, as things are getting worse, as banks are still not lending, it goes to outright quantitative easing. But this is 2015. And the US and the UK have been doing it since 2008. So what you get here is, this is, you know, hiding in plain view the change, because they're legitimating what they're doing all the way through by changing the discourse from a discourse of it's all about credibility to one of stability, and the medium term means we can do whatever it takes for stability. So very important to see, it's a discursive process, and it's also political, because Draghi goes and has a charm offensive, according to Peter Spiegel of the Financial Times, for over a year, talking to Merkel. And he tries to isolate the Bundesbank and manages, essentially, and tries to convince the EP. And leadership matters. Trichet didn't really know macroeconomics. He was a civil servant, a French civil servant. And whereas Draghi was a firefighter. And was a, okay, but so that's ECB as hero, but it's also an ogre. Austerity and structural reform, it's the ECB. This is a quid pro quo. It said, okay, look, if we're going to do something because you, the council, are refusing to do anything, then in exchange, austerity, structural reform. I mean, they're true ordo-liberals plus neoliberals, and basically, you've got to make people follow the rules. And then you can ask about input illegitimacy in terms of Trichet's letters to various heads of state. At moments of crisis, saying you get into a program, and in fact, if you don't, we'll pull the money. You know, we'll pull the plug on you in terms of liquidity, etc. And you're going to have to go into a program anyway. So do it. You know, you can do it gently, or you can do it brutally. Okay, that's the ECB. I think I'm almost out of time, so I'm just going to do. That's a nice story. The council. The big question here is, dictator or deliberative body, is it the diktats of Germany? And here we can use a principal agent theory, or we can use a hard bargaining, rational choice argument here. Germany's power of one in a hard bargaining arena with massive intergovernmentalism. And the examples are pushing the numbers, delaying the rules and stringent rules and numbers, delaying Greek bailout. But there's also the German Constitutional Court that's involved. You know, it's the only one that claims we're illegitimate input-wise. Is it German diktats, which the Greeks would tell you, or is it deliberative political body, a consensus-seeking body? So whereas the rational choice people argue that it's, you know, a bargaining arena, and of course, it's German diktats, French and Wolfenig, you get Weyputer and these new intergovernmentalists saying, no, it's a consensus-seeking body. Okay, possibly, I mean, because they do, you know, how else do you explain the fact that they're all sitting around the table and they're all agreeing to, yes, kill me gently, or not so gently. They're all agreeing, so maybe it is about persuasion. But if so, it's in the shadow of Germany, because it's Germany sitting there as the power, as the weight, basically saying there's no other way. But still, you know, there is deliberation, and you see a change in discourse over time. You go from a stability discourse basically said no change to growth when first Mario Monti and then François Hollande backs him up, saying we need growth, and this is 2012, and this is when you see the Commission actually starting to change what it's doing in terms of the European semester. And then by 2014, you get Renzi, followed again by Hollande, saying we need flexibility, and then the Commission is, you know, increasingly flexible. And there's increasing politicization and contestation during this time, so you could argue, well, maybe this is a deliberative body, as opposed to simply a hard bargaining arena. And then we get investment. So that's the Council. Commission, Ayatollahs of austerity, or ministers of moderation. I should tell you that I had a fellowship, a part-time fellowship, with Directorate General of Economics and Finance, DGEF, and they asked if I would, you know, they had a competition, they asked if I would apply to talk to them about legitimacy. I said, of course. I applied, and then I was there for a year on this part-time fellowship, and the first big event where you had to present preliminary ideas, I went in and I said, you know, Paul Krugman likes to talk about you as the Reign of Terror, as in Olly Rehn. But I prefer to think of you as Ayatollahs of austerity. Everyone laughs, thinking that I'm joking. But essentially, after a year there, I realized, wait a minute, something else is going on. I talked to a lot of people, and they kept saying, you know, but you're, you know, I was responding to the harsh discourse of Olly Rehn, austerity and structural reform, because on the outside, that's all you see. But on the inside, they kept saying, see, look at what we write. And I said, well, what do you write? Look at the annual growth survey. Look at our country reports. And what you see over time is you see incremental change and you see a tremendous softening of the way in which they're interpreting the rules. They really do become ministers of moderation. And it is about legitimacy. They're recognizing this is not working. The harsh austerity and structural reform is not giving these countries the jolt that they need to then to start growing again. They're in a double dip recession. It's not working. And so they then themselves decide, 2013, derogations to the rules for France and Italy and Spain. No, not Spain. Oh, wait, but Spain comes up with a new calculation for how to deal with the unemployment level that makes it possible for them to say, really, we, you know, the primary surplus were okay, or the structural deficit, or whatever it was, and they're out as well. So they really were ministers of moderation. But who knows? And that's the problem. And this is the whole thing about legitimacy. Everyone still thinks, and all of we academics were writing as if they were the worst brutes, as if they really were the Ayatollahs of austerity. But in fact, they'd already slowly changed. So much so that what you saw is, for example, for structural reform, the fiscal austerity's headline goal in the annual growth surveys every year until 2015, when it completely shifts to investment, when Juncker comes in. But number two, the definition of structural reform changes massively. It goes from, structural reform basically means kill the unions, you know, deregulate labor markets, rationalize the welfare state, meaning cut. And number three said, you know, basically think about poverty. But over time, what you see, by the next year or 2 years later, what you see is structural reform means bring in the social partners, business and labor, talk to them, do whatever you can to make things work. And number three becomes much more forceful about poverty is a serious issue, you need to do something. And then, of course, 2015, the new Juncker Commission comes in, and they say, we're now going to have rules for flexibility. What? But anyway, at least it's more legitimate. They got the message that I and a number of other people have been sending them, or saying. But also, investment is headline goal number one. Number two, structural reform now is even more, you know, basically cooperate with labor unions, see whatever you can do, and number three is about fiscal consolidation, but now it's called growth-friendly fiscal consolidation, whatever that means. Okay, so that's the Commission, so we're not going to look at this. And you can also see a change in terms of the discourse. It's less significant, but it's all about competitiveness. Structural reform goes down, competitiveness goes up. Parliament, basically, well, I'll leave that. It's the least interesting story, but you know, is it a talking shop? Is it becoming more of an equal partner? The one major thing is it's becoming more of a go-to body for legitimacy, as all of the other EU institutional actors recognize that they need to make clear what it is they're doing, and the best way to do that is go to the Parliament and talk to the Parliament, which then gets reported more generally. Conclusion one, I have three of these slides, I'm going way over, but more output legitimacy via more or less integration, more fiscal federalism, and this would be, we need to do something about the debt overload in Greece, but also Italy. We need innovative ideas, things like Eurobonds, individual deposit insurance, a Europe-wide unemployment insurance, EU investment funds that really dwarfs the Juncker plan, an EU budget, all of these things everyone's been talking about for ages. And think tanks, over and over and over again, the EU Commission itself has taken these things up. Nothing's happened. But if you can't have more, how about less? Why not allow member states to make their own investment using their own resources? Because the way the debt break rule is set, you can't. I mean, for countries in Southern Europe, they cannot take on more debt in order to invest in growth, in growth areas, or in areas that would be growth for the future. They can't invest. You know, education, training, infrastructure, etc. So all you have to do, there's an easy fix, just don't count any of these kinds of investments to their deficits, and you're fine, and you don't need to change any treaties. More solidarity, and this, of course, you need all of these kinds of, anyway, I'm not going to talk about this because that takes too long, but a variety of small funds that might help solve things. Conclusion two, more input legitimacy by changing the rules and improving representation and the unanimity rule, which is why it's almost impossible to change anything. Turn treaty-based laws into ordinary legislation. And the EU Council can now do that. But basically, it would mean that you can then amend them. That would make it possible to change the stability rules. Have opt-outs on new legislation. I'm not going to talk about that. But that's for exceptional reasons, so that you don't end up with the UK leaving, etc. Bring citizens in more directly. Perhaps via national parliaments and via European Parliament, and more co-decision method, or community method. But that's a no-brainer, and they're doing that already. Conclusion three, rethinking the Eurozone processes for more throughput legitimacy. Make the European semester bottom-up and truly flexible instead of top-down. So this is a bit more complicated, but obviously, you're going to continue having these rules for a while longer, however much you soften them, so you can continue EU coordination and oversight. That's actually not a bad idea for countries that are not very good at solving their own problems. But you need to give back control to the national level. And in fact, national control is at the national level, but it appears massively hierarchical. It appears to Marine Le Pen as if the EU Commission is telling France what to do, even though there's a prior stage when the French say, okay, this is as much as we're gonna do, what do you think? And then the Commission comes back, and then, anyway, back and forth. But basically, make it bottom up. Quit this kind of top down. And if you do that, it's tremendously important in terms of countering the populist drift. Because then, you know, allow the member states to decide, we're gonna do a bit more fiscal stimulus, a bit more left-wing versus right-wing policies, so that you can actually bring back debate over economic policies at the national level. It's a way to combat the populist claims to be the only alternative to EU technocratic rule. And in the interim, you can even have, but this is pie in the sky, differentiated recommendations. So, you know, the ECB says there's one target, everyone needs to reduce their deficits and their inflation rates, et cetera. But you know, these countries are very different. Why not have differential rates for Ireland or Portugal or, you know, depending upon where the economies are, and have that discussed. Have the Commission talk to the various countries, come up with a figure that meets the overall target, but is different for different countries. Have it discussed in the context of the Council and the European Parliament. And you end up with something akin to democracy or democratic deliberation at the EU level. Anyway, totally pie in the sky, but it seems to me that that's probably one of the only ways in which you can bring back some more political legitimacy or input legitimacy into what has become a highly